This map gives the layout of the exercise. It represents a stretch of British coast and an area of enemy-occupied country, with a channel in between. According to the story, the enemy coast was to be invaded by an imaginary force of two British armies, supported on the left by an independent corps of two divisions, which was to push northwards with the object of securing a port area for the subsequent maintenance of the invading forces. This corps only was represented in the exercise. In actual fact, First Corps landing took place on a stretch of South Wales coastline bordering on the Bristol Channel, and for reasons of convenience, the same strip of coast was used for embarkation. This was carried out at Port Talbot, Swansea and Tenby, and the landing at Carmarthen Bay. The troops were first moved into concentration areas where they prepared for embarkation and carried out the first two stages of vehicle waterproofing. When this was done, they moved in their order of embarkation to assembly areas nearer the coast. Here, units were broken down into ship and craft loads. And within 24 hours, these subunits were moved on to transit areas just behind the points of embarkation, where they completed the waterproofing of their vehicles and awaited their turn to embark. A large proportion of the units, for whom there were no craft available, were moved direct from the assembly areas to the landing beaches by road. Landing craft and ships used in the exercise were one flotilla of 12 landing craft personnel, 16 alligator amphibians, three flotillas, each of 12 fire-driven landing barges, 36 large and small coasters, of which 5 were used for MT, and the folding boat equipment which goes with them. At Port Talbot and Swansea, the loading of coasters began some time ahead of the start of the exercise. Owing to the lack of suitable landing craft, no armoured fighting vehicles took part. But load-carrying vehicles with their G-1098 and allotted operational stores and also mechanised equipment such as dumpers were put on board. But care had to be taken not to load anything on the cranes that couldn't be managed later by the ship's derricks, as they were the only means of unloading onto the beaches. It was important to load prime movers with their trailers so that the latter could be towed off the beaches immediately on arrival. Three methods of loading stores were employed. These were based on the estimated progress of the landing operations. To meet the requirements of the first 4 days, coasters were loaded tactically so that each carried a proportion of the types of stores necessary to meet immediate requirements. This prevented all the eggs being put into one basket during the first few days, when risks from enemy action were greatest, and also ensured a quick build-up of fighting stores. From D plus 5 to D plus 10, the composite method was adopted. This was to meet the day-to-day requirements of the force and consisted of balanced quantities of basic stores. From D plus 11, loading was on a commodity basis, which meant that each ship carried stores in bulk. Thus, over a period of 14 days, the task of the beach organization was to deliver a total of 23,000 tons of stores to build up reserves as well as to provide for daily requirements. When embarkation was completed, coasters sailed to the waiting position off the enemy coast. At Tenby, where embarkation of B vehicles and a limited number of personnel was carried out from the beaches, trackways were laid up to the ramps of the barges. These barges were used instead of landing craft mechanized and landing craft tank. Note that the ramp of the barge is at the stern. Personnel were embarked in LCP and barges representing assault craft. Some of them found the weight of their kit too much during the march from the assembly areas to the beaches, and transport had to be provided to ensure that they embarked fresh. The value of training drivers in maneuvering vehicles into landing craft became very obvious. In some cases, the steep slope of the ramp presented difficulties even to trained drivers, and winching and manhandling became necessary. This is not the correct way to signal a vehicle into a lane. The barges were now ready to proceed direct to the beaches for unloading. Now let's turn to the assault landing. The beaches in Carmarthen Bay were flat, but backed on the eastern stretch by a formidable shingle bank. The tidal range was considerable. The hinterland hilly and broken, and the few roads through it, steep and narrow. Further inland, both ground and roads were more favorable. In the assault plan, the bay was divided into sectors, and the assaulting formations were to establish an intermediate position within 4 hours of the initial landing. Within the next 14 hours, they were to push on and secure a covering position to protect the landing and assembly of the remainder of the corps. The covering position was to be extended on D+3 to give more room, and the general advance of 1st Corps was to begin on D+6. Under the 1st key maintenance plan, 2 beach maintenance areas were to be set up by 2 beach groups under the control of a beach sub-area commander to supply the initial needs of the landing. By D+7, these beach maintenance areas were to be absorbed into a 4th maintenance area extending some 7 miles inland under a base sub-area commander operating at the same headquarters. This meant that from then on, the supply service of the beach maintenance areas would be superseded by that of the force maintenance area. For the air support, 2 advanced landing grounds were required. These were to be obtained by repairing an imaginary enemy airfield on the west and by constructing a new airfield on the east. Zero hour was at 12:30 midday on the 22nd of July, a fine summer day with exceptionally high tide. The landing took place in daylight to prepare for the arrival of the first flight of coasters on the noon tide the following day. The assault was carried out according to the orders and landing tables previously prepared by 1st Corps and its assault formations, whose skeleton headquarters took part in the landing. The tactical picture was painted to beach groups by umpires, and this was also broadcast to spectators. 2 beach groups came ashore on the timings of their respective brigade groups. Those who came by land were moved onto the beaches according to the scheduled times of their landings. Then they carried on just as though they had been landed from the sea. 1 naval commando took part and was divided between the 2 beach groups. Naval beach signals were also represented. Enemy resistance in the vicinity of the beaches was assumed to have ended soon after the assault landing. No actual mines were laid or demolition effected, but umpires described the enemy defense measures and imposed delay on reconnaissance and action. The 2 beach groups were then able to prepare the beach exits and dumps for the reception of stores on D+1. Beaches on 3 sectors of the assault front were prepared for maintenance. On X-ray sector, the beach exits were easily constructed. But on Uncle and Victor sectors, the steep shingle bank made exit difficult. Beach traffic signs were quickly set up by naval commando and provo personnel. The problem of wheeled routes over the shingle bank on Uncle Victor sector was solved by chest paling brought in on trailers towed by bulldozers. The chest paling combined with Sommerfeld track made a good service, and beaches were ready to receive vehicles by Z+5 hours. Beach company headquarters were all set to deal with traffic on arrival. During the afternoon of D-Day, MT barges began to come in, and the landing of vehicles began as soon as the tide had receded far enough. Nevertheless, many of the vehicles were landed too early. They should have been held on board until the water level had fallen to the vehicle waiting limit. As it was, many trucks were driven ashore through too deep water. The steep slope of the barge ramp caused them to take a real header, and unless waterproofing was 100%, vehicles were drowned. Fortunately, Remy were on hand with their recovery equipment, and they were able to deal with all the casualties. Casualties were taken to the drowned vehicle parks close behind the beaches. Normally, one park per sector ought to be enough. Recovery of vehicles should be on a strict priority and under the general control of Beach Group headquarters. This is the only way of ensuring an economical use of mechanical equipment. Personnel of units of beach groups and administrative services continued to land from barges and landing craft personnel throughout the exercise. But like vehicles, men shouldn't have to go through water more than is really necessary. Too many waded ashore and arrived in the assembly areas soaked. Craft loads of personnel were directed to transit areas close behind the beaches, where they were formed into unit or subunit parties and passed on inland to unit assembly areas. Light and heavy ACAG batteries were attached to the beach groups during the assault landing, and several small-scale attacks were made by the enemy aircraft. Later, the command of ACAC Defense passed to ACAC Brigade Headquarters. The evacuation of wounded by sea was not attempted, but medical services in the beach groups had to deal with a number of casualties, not all of them rehearsed. It was estimated that the beach dressing stations would have to hold 400 casualties per group, but the space made available in the exercise was not large enough for this. The recce parties of the beach group's headquarters landed about an hour after zero. After some delay due to enemy opposition, they recced their beach maintenance areas. Both beach group commanders found it necessary to amend their first key plans to site dumps further inland and alter traffic circuits. Assistant Senior Naval Officer Landing guided in the first flight of coasters at 1300 hours on D plus one. The ships were flagged into their berths by the naval commando. Two coasters beached on X-ray and four on Uncle Victor. The sea was smooth and the beaching successful. Then came the job of unloading stores. Here are some of the methods used. Before the coaster dried out, folding boat equipment was used to carry stores ashore. But these boats were very susceptible to weather and could only deal with easily handled stores. They were discontinued after D plus two, and were then kept as a reserve for emergency ferrying. Alligators were used in place of ducks. The alligator has a small capacity and is difficult to unload. It's also unseaworthy in rough weather, and on land its tracks are very destructive, nor can it move very quickly. In view of these shortcomings, it should be confined to journeys between ships and the back of the beach. There were 16 alligators available, and they were all allotted to Uncle Victor sector to tackle the shingle bank, which they did very successfully. But there was considerable wear and tear on them, and gradually they were eliminated from the operation. When the tide went out, the coasters dried out for about 8 hours. In this period, lorries were used, and the normal method of discharge from ship to lorries alongside was employed. For the main part, the surface of the beaches was hard sand, which was ideal for the lorries. Barges were also used and took in stores from coasters, both when they were beached and afloat. In this way, the constant flow of stores was kept up. Four barges to each coaster proved sufficient, but it must be remembered that using them involves a double handling of stores, and this upset some of the stowage priorities. Also, they must be carefully trimmed, otherwise they become unmanageable. Beaching a barge stern on to the shore, alongside a coaster drawing twice as much water, and within reach of the coaster's derrick, requires skill and experience. When the tide had gone out far enough, lorries came into the picture. Stores which had been transferred from coasters to barges were now loaded onto them. In this way, coasters could be cleared as soon as possible and sail on the following tide. The cranes of the ME sections were employed for transferring awkward and heavy loads from craft to lorries. All the RB-10s and 19s were available for lifting stores on the beaches, except for occasional maintenance work on the shingle bank tracks of Uncle Victor Sector. The personnel of the docks operating company were landed from the first flight of coasters. At first, they were confined to handling stores in these ships, but later it became necessary to employ them in the barges to supervise stowage. Weather conditions continued favorable, and the work of unloading was not interfered with. But it was soon obvious that the inexperience of the beach groups in using barges was causing delay. By the evening of D plus 7, there were 6 coasters and 11 barges on the beaches which had still not completed discharging. The alligators had ceased to help. Unloading continued via the barges, but the job became very complicated and slow owing to the mixed loading of the coasters. Another thing which held up the discharge was delay in the return of the lorries from the dumps. In an effort to overcome these snags, one beach group resorted to temporary dumping at the back of the beaches and called in unit and AK-AK battery transport to help. The delay caused by the long turnaround of lorries was further aggravated by a lack of uniformity in traffic signs. The sites of the ammunition sections in both Ordnance Beach detachments were altered in the second key plan. The site in one beach group was alongside a two-way road, and it was easier to work. But more use might have been made of the grass verge for the movement of lorries. The main disadvantage was the flat, open nature of the country, and here the lack of experience in making the best use of natural cover for stacks and tracks was evident. Some of the loading was untidy and rough. Yes, very rough. The issue of stores to fighting formations was dealt with by a neutral organization, which collected by lorry convoy from the dumps and evacuated to railheads. This method of withdrawal, based on the estimated daily demands of the imaginary fighting troops, was applied later in the force maintenance area. Labor in the Ordnance Beach detachments was provided by infantry companies of the beach battalions until the increasing demand on the beaches caused them to be withdrawn. Labor on the dumps was then left to the Ordnance personnel, who didn't fail to make use of natural cover. The field company in each beach group was responsible for handling RE stores as well as for the work on tracks, roads, and obstructions in the beach maintenance area. The field company headquarters found it difficult to provide the necessary stores control staff to handle all the RE material required by the beach maintenance areas and the assault formations which they served. But it must be remembered that this material covered an extremely wide variety of stores. Awkward loads were included in the stores delivered over the beaches, and it was necessary to have cranes in the dumps to handle them. Back on the beach, water delivered in 2-gallon cans was suspected of being tainted and had to be emptied. As soon as possible, water points were set up by the field companies and provided an ample supply for the units of the beach groups and other units passing through the beach maintenance areas. It's of great importance that no use should be made of local water supplies until authorization has come through. This precaution, however, was not always observed. The importance of salvage was not forgotten in the exercise, A salvage unit was included in the order of battle for the force maintenance area. Each dump and depot was responsible for salvage in its own area, and a considerable quantity was collected and eventually disposed of in the proper manner. The field dressing stations in the beach maintenance areas were in operation on D-Day, and the casualty clearing stations opened on D+1. Both were handicapped by the long ambulance turnaround, which caused delay in handling casualties. Although casualties were few, there were enough to test the resources of the medical services, including those of the surgical units. The construction and repair of airfields was taken into account in the exercise, but the RAF only participated on the administrative side. The actual work on the ground was done by the Army. An airfield construction group of the REs got to work. This group consisted of a works company, an ME section, and four pioneer companies, and they laid out a landing strip 1,200 yards in length. The intention was to complete this strip within 48 hours, but this turned out to be an optimistic estimate, and it was not in fact ready for use until 1,100 hours on D+4. This was due to the fact that although the recce party and the first detachment of the group landed on D-Day, the first consignment of stores on wheels did not reach the site until after dark on D+1. Delay in starting caused a scramble and made rather a rough job of it. Just a single track was laid, and no attempt was made to construct either the taxi track or dispersal points. A ground defense squadron and an attack squadron of the RAF regiment provided protection for the airfield. The first aircraft landed at 16:30 hours on D+4, and further landings were made on D+5. The strip was found to be suitable for the heavier types of fighter, but on the rough side for the lighter types. An RAF servicing commando was ready to receive aircraft when they landed, but no ammunition and no POL were available at first. The reason for this was that although an RAF beach unit was included in each beach group to pick out their own stores and supervise their delivery to the airfield, they failed to do this in the first days of the landing, owing to the difficulty in distinguishing RAF from Army stores. The supply service was not in full operation until D+7. Delivery to the dumps in the beach maintenance areas ceased on D+6 and began to the depots of the force maintenance area. In order to relieve the strain imposed on the Ordnance Beach detachment of one of the beach groups, the base ammunition depot opened for issues on D+6. The other depots opened on D+7. The transport service was handicapped by the depth of the force maintenance area, and this caused delay in the turnaround of the lorries running from the beaches. Reinforcements of lorry units had to be attached to the general transport companies of the beach groups. Depots and workshops of the force maintenance area gained useful experience in their field duties. The fact that vehicles of the fighting troops were not taking part in the exercise, of course, made their job a lot lighter. The standard of unit administration naturally varied with the experience of the unit in living and working under field service conditions. The good weather during the first week of the exercise gave the operation a comfortable start, and living in bivouac was no hardship. Rest periods were imposed and troops in the maintenance area were kept informed of the progress of operations through daily intelligence summaries, whose value, unfortunately, was not fully appreciated. But when the weather broke, the need for further training, particularly in field hygiene, became obvious. Here are some scenes from one of the local attacks which occurred during the exercise. The pioneers and technical personnel made a quick turnover from labor to defense. The Home Guard supplied the enemy action. They made various guerrilla raids on installations and convoys, and also attacked the beach fronts. On D+5, lines of communication signals had to make extensive alterations to their signals layout, and the main signals artery had to be laid along a major road instead of following a more concealed route. This because the commander base sub area had decided to move his headquarters further inland. Long-range wireless communication established a link with Advanced First Corps headquarters and with a station representing GHQ. The commander beach sub area took the opportunity to move his headquarters nearer the beach so as to be in closer touch with events on the beach front. This was fortunate, for on D+10, the weather turned very stormy. Two coasters were driven up onto the beach, and a flotilla of barges was put out of commission. X-ray sector had to be closed, and transport and labor diverted to the other sector. Concrete barges of a bulk petrol installation delivering fuel through pipelines to storage tanks inland were an additional problem. On arrival at the beachfront, they were found to be leaking. A bulldozer attempted to seal the leak with sand, but this didn't stop the flow of petrol, and it was decided to pump it out of the barges into petrol lorries. A detachment of the local NFS was called in to stand by because of the danger of fire. The petrol spread with considerable rapidity along the front of X-ray sector, and even got as far as Uncle Victor sector, although only in small quantities. The danger to personnel in handling POL stores fully justified the temporary closing of X-ray. The exercise also raised some doubt about the safety of handling jerry cans on roller runway. During the exercise, several periods were given over to working in anti-gas clothing. By the end of the exercise, the situation was as follows. The dumps in the beach maintenance areas have been disposed of, and supply is carried out by the depots of the force maintenance area, more suitably entitled rear maintenance area. In effect, the beach maintenance areas are now transit areas through which the beach groups pass the stores landed on the beaches. For reasons of suitable ground and roads, the rear maintenance area was extended some considerable distance inland. This caused a long journey from the beaches to the depots and, as a consequence, an uneven flow and at times a shortage of lorries on the beach front. This delay in turnaround made it impossible to take full advantage of unloading while the tide was out. And reinforcement by additional transport units untrained in beach duties didn't compensate for this. It was therefore clearly demonstrated that it was not economical to run transport direct from the beach to the depots. The solution appears to be to convert beach maintenance areas into stores transit areas, where vehicles can offload and return to the beaches. The stores can then be sorted and picked up by another echelon of transport for conveyance to rear maintenance area depots. In terms of tonnage, then, what the beach groups were intended to achieve in 13 days of solid work was 23,400 tons, or a daily average of 900 tons. What, in fact, they did achieve was 16,230 tons, or a daily average of 625 tons. This exercise was the first attempt to move large quantities of stores over beaches with a considerable tidal range. It was unreal in that the craft and equipment used were not up to date, and no fighting troops or vehicles were handled. The organization for beach maintenance was nevertheless shown to be sound. But if the beach groups and other administrative troops concerned are to carry out their task, they must have sufficient individual and collective training. Although shipping was adequate, the needs of First Corps were not fully met, partly because of interruptions by bad weather and the leakage of petrol on the beachfront, but mainly owing to congestion on the beaches caused by complicated coaster loads, lack of experience in working with barges, and uneconomical use of transport. Priority of stores must be carefully worked out. G, 1098 equipment confined to essentials, while all stores going ashore during the first days should be in packages which can be handled. Simplicity in stowage will assist quick unloading. Mechanical equipment must be available to deal with heavier stores. Tactical loading is uneconomical. A better method is the stowage of small coasters on the basis of one commodity per hold. This will allow clearance on one tide. But there must be military supervision of the loading at home ports. Above all, personnel must be collectively trained. Only this will ensure a maximum flow of troops, equipment, and stores over the beaches and carry the organization through all the hazards of invasion.